I'm Kevin Schmidt. I am happy to welcome you all to our latest talk at Google. This time we have Mike Rizzo, who has written a book on the history of Washington beer. He is a longtime homebrewer. He recently just finished up hosting a podcast also on Washington beer. So definitely an experienced person. So yeah. Join me in welcoming Mike Rizzo.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for coming, appreciate it. Yes, I've written, well, I'm originally from the East Coast, and I've written, this is my seventh book, written all history books, and up to this point, right before this, I wrote Buffalo Beer, which is a history of just Buffalo, New York's brewing, which was pretty much ended by the early 70s. They didn't have any new craft brewers until the late 90s, and now it's starting to grow there. Washington has a great long history that kind of never ended. What we'll do is we'll go through a few different things, and I'll talk to, later on I can answer any questions anybody has. But one thing that's kind of fun that I found when I was writing this, something you wouldn't see too often, but in 1859, there was a jury deliberating, and they went out and asked for a meal. And that meal included one ham, 12 dozen eggs, 2 pounds of butter, 6 loaves of bread, 3 cans of oysters, 3 cans of pears, 3 cans of peaches, 1 gallon of Scotch whiskey, and 5 gallons of lager. So obviously that must have been a good deliberation, but I don't think they allow that anymore. But that was a fun thing I found when going through it. Now, currently there are I believe it's 320 active breweries in Washington. So it is a pretty populous brewing state. At this point, it's number 2 to California. New York is starting to grow. It took a long time, but they're starting to grow quickly. But California has over 700, so it would be tough for Washington to catch them. At one point, just a few years ago, the number of breweries here, it was the most per capita of any other state. That may have changed, but it's still very populous, and I'm sure you know there's breweries within minutes of here, and they're everywhere throughout the state. It's just pretty interesting. My wife and I started a podcast 2 years ago. We just ended it in November, but we did almost 200 episodes, 100 episodes. And what we found in interviewing, you know, all of these brewers and breweries, the owners. For the most part, we interviewed the owners, but a lot of times they were also the brewers. Sometimes they were just owners. It was very different looking at it. Sometimes you'd get somebody that was a home brewer that would come in with the great idea, they had great beer that, you know, like American Idol, you've got the best beer, you've got the best voice, you know, you should go and sell it. And a lot of times they really did have good beer. And then you had other ones that just had deep pockets and they opened up a big brewery and hired people. And a lot of times their beer was just as good too. So it was very interesting seeing the contrast from the small. Sometimes we went to one that had a tap room that was 3 people big. To, you know, some of the biggest ones that are in the state. So, problem writing something like this, Washington Beer, which is a history from the beginning, which is before Washington was a state when it was still a territory, up until today, is I had a page limit. So there was a limit on to, you know, what I could write and how much I could write. When I was done, I handed my manuscript in, and I was 40,000 words over. So they told me, I could cut a few things. Ended up having to move the references offline or online, basically, so you could pick them up on a PDF, or cut a bunch of stuff. So I had to do a little bit of both. So we moved the references offline or online, I keep saying, but ended up having to cut a lot. And what got cut was a lot of the newer breweries, just because they don't have a lot of history. And, you know, we had tried to write as much history as we could about a lot of the newer breweries, but they ended up getting cut down to a sentence or two. Most of them still made it, so we tried to get it like up to the last minute, up until it had to be turned in. There were literally breweries opening, you know, a week after I was, submitted this. So we were struggling to try and get everyone we could. Did a pretty good job capturing all of them, but that was the biggest thing, just trying to get every brewery. The beginning, obviously, you're going to start back in the 1800s. When the state wasn't a state yet, it was still a territory, and you had some pioneers coming to the area, and they were settling primarily in areas where there were forts. There was Fort Vancouver, Fort Colville, and they would open a brewery because there's soldiers there. Soldiers like to drink, and it was usually a pretty good place for them to start a business. And generally, a lot of them were also, it was like a self-contained business where they had the brewery, they had a tap room or a tavern. They usually lived on the property, whether it was upstairs, next door, somewhere close by. And a lot of them, and this isn't just here, but in general, a lot of the old ones in the pre-Prohibition days were also like the town meeting spot. So a lot of times it would be, you know, where people would come and talk politics or talk business and things like that. So that's what a lot of them were. And you can see that today in some of the, especially the smaller breweries, some of them, especially ones that are the only brewery in certain towns. They're the place where people go and hang out. You know, maybe they don't discuss, politics, but it's the place where people go, and it's a community meeting spot. And that's pretty popular in a lot of them in common. Now, there were a lot of different pioneers across the state. A lot of them, if you've homebrewed or if you know anything about brewing, a lot of it was from German ancestry. So a lot of them were of German descent. They came from, you know, some area over in Europe that they probably spoke German, and some of them were brewers back home. Some of them, you know, learned it as a trade, and some of them learned it here. You had people like John Munch, Henry Weinard, who you might know that name, because Weinard is still around, Charles Wood, Bernhard Scheid, and John Heber. By the 1860s, there were breweries across the territory, so things were growing relatively quick. Now, many colorful characters would come out of this, as in any type of growing community of businesses like that. There's usually different people that have something that creates interest in from other people. John and Catherine Stahl, they opened a brewery in Walla Walla, one of the earlier ones, and they produced steam beer, if you've heard of Anchor Steam, similar type of beer. That's what they were producing, and they produced that until 1888. He died, and actually he got sick, so she took over the brewery and ran the brewery, which was not a very common thing for a woman to be running a big business. Number one, but also a brewery was not a very common thing. But she ran the business very competently, grew the business, they incorporated, and she died in 1908, left it an estate in today's dollars of $2.8 million. So she did pretty good for herself. Another one was a man, Martin Schmeig, who started North Pacific Brewing in Seattle with a partner in 1865. Now that brewery was going on for a few years. The partner split, and then what happens is Martin's wife died. Must have been a very traumatic thing for him, because he decided he was gonna go back to the homeland, And he didn't say for how long, but he was going to go back and he was going to, you know, visit and rest and whatever he was going to do. So he decided to leave the business in the competent hands of one of his employees, a guy named August Melhorn, who had started out as a delivery driver with the horse and wagon. But he had worked his way up into the brewery, leaves the brewery to him to run. But he didn't leave him the money to run the brewery. So he's running the brewery and they have multiple bills, they have employees, they have a lot of things going on. And what happens is no money to pay anybody. So he found that the only way that this was gonna fix itself was if he basically sued the brewery. So he ended up having the sheriff take a lien out on the building and the brewery. He ended up going to auction and nobody else showed up for the auction. So he had no choice but to actually bid on the brewery himself. So he bid on the brewery and took it over and he ran it for a while after that. But that was his only way to recourse at that point. So now, I'm guessing that a lot of you know that if you're interested in beer, hops is an important ingredient. And Washington is one of the biggest hops producers in the country. And that was something that started back in the 1800s. Originally, central New York was the hops capital of the country. That's the East Coast was, and it just happened to be, that's where the most population was at the time. And so central New York had the right conditions to grow hops, and then they had some issues going on. And a couple things happened. Two things. First, a brewer out of Olympia, Charles Wood, sent some cuttings to a guy named Jacob Meeker. You may have heard of the Meekers, Jacob and Ezra, father and son. They were in the Puyallup Valley. And what they did was they planted these cuttings and slowly grew this business until they had the Puyallup Valley, originally in Western Washington, was the capital of hops in the state. This is where they grew until they had over, every year they would expand it, until they had over 500 acres of hops. They grew, they opened an office in London, and they were the kings of hops for many years. And originally what happens is a guy named Henry Weiner said that they were the finest hops that he had ever used. And that was really what got them going. He said that he would purchase hops from them every season. And for 14 straight years, he bought hops for them, which really gave them that kick that they needed to keep the business growing. So for 26 years, they were in business growing hops and really expanding this and making this a worthwhile business. And it was the largest hop company in the world at their peak. Now, another guy, Charles Carpenter, his family is from central New York, and he moved west. When he came, he brought some hop cuttings with him. And he settled in Moxie in eastern Washington. And what he did was he planted his hop cuttings there. And eventually, they grew and expanded. And that area, and eastern Washington primarily, is where most of the hops are grown. And the Carpenter family is actually still in business. They're part of three or four families. I forget the name of the company. Hop Union, one of those companies that still make hop or grow hops. So they're still doing business. Approximately 70% of the country's hops are grown right here in Washington and mostly in eastern Washington. So it's a big business. Now, there were multiple famous brands from the state. Can anybody name any of the brands that were popular? A couple of them are still around, different owners.
Rainier back then?
Rainier, yep, Rainier. There was also Ole, Olympia Beer. That was another popular one. Lucky Lager came out of Vancouver. And those were three of the more prominent brands that grew over time. Now, Rainier began in the 1870s. And in 1893, three different breweries that had been in operation were merged together. They were all purchased and merged together to form what became known as Seattle Brewing and Malting Company. And it was controlled by the Hemridge family, and they were the ones that that made this happen. And they, by doing this, they bought the one company that had the Rainier brand. And over time, they grew it until, well, at this point, when they merged these three breweries, they had a capacity of 150,000 barrels. That's a pretty good size. The biggest brewery in Washington right now, outside of Red Hook in Woodinville, is going to be Fremont. And their capacity, when they're done, is supposed to be about 180,000. So these guys were pretty big in the 1890s. Now, they didn't actually trademark their Rainier brand and name until 1907. So somebody, I guess, could have stole it and they could have fought over it, but they were able to get away with that. 1909, they had 400 employees, and they were the sixth largest brewery in the country. So they'd grown pretty fast, and they were a decent-sized brewery. Now, the other one we mentioned, Olympia, was started by Leopold Schmidt, nice German man. He started in Montana. He opened a brewery there. He was involved in politics, and he had to go to Olympia at one point to discuss something with politicians there. And he saw the water, Tumwater, which is a suburb right there, saw that the water was this great artesian water, and he decided that he wanted to build a brewery right there. So what he does is he sells his brewery in Montana, builds a brewery there on Tumwater, Tumwater Falls there, and that originally is known as the Capital Brewing Company, which opened in 1896. In 1902, it was renamed the Olympia Brewing Company. Now, does anybody know when Prohibition started? All right, that's a tough question. It started in 1920. That's when it began, so we're almost 100 years there. But in Washington, as soon as Washington became a state, the anti-saloon league, the temperance movement, immediately started pushing to have prohibition here in Washington. The year after Washington was a state, they had a vote to go dry, but it didn't pass. But they didn't give up. And in 1915, they had another vote, and it went through. And beginning in January 1916, Washington actually went dry before the country did. Nobody knew if there was going to be prohibition nationwide. So what happens is there were a couple smart businessmen that figured out what they could do. You had Pacific Brewing and Malting in Tacoma, and you had Seattle Brewing and Malting in Seattle, both built plants down in San Francisco. So they shifted all their production down to San Francisco, and they were able to keep producing beer. And that worked pretty well for them. Most of the other plants around the state, if they didn't have a plan, they shut down. Some of them went into fruit juice or fruit manufacturing. Some of them did soaps and other variety of things. They tried to keep their employees going, and you know, for some of them, they were able to survive. But for the most part, and this goes nationwide, prohibition killed most breweries. The original high number of breweries was in the 1890s or 1880s. We just surpassed that last year, the number of breweries. So it took a long time for that to come back around. Now, there's another guy who was involved in brewing. His name is Harry Crosby. He's from Tacoma. Got a job at Inland Brewing in Spokane. So he moved his family out to Spokane. And what happened is, you know, the whole prohibition thing came around. And he kept getting demoted because originally he was like head bookkeeper. And then he got pushed down until he was like a shipping clerk, because business was getting smaller and smaller. So what he had is one of his sons came working for him, and that son was Harry Jr., and his nickname was Bing. Bing Crosby worked at this brewery for a short time. Excuse me. When they were manufacturing or brining pickles. They were doing, and they were kosher pickles too. So he worked there for like a short time, and once they started doing the pickles, he was there for like 2 weeks. Realized that he hated pickles, and quit. And eventually moved his family to Hollywood and became the famous man that he has become. But he apparently never ate pickles after that. So. So Prohibition brought about a lot of crime. This is where organized crime really takes, you know, takes foothold. If anybody's ever watched or read anything about organized crime, about the mafia, Prohibition is what made them in the United States what they are or what they were, because they took advantage of this time when people wanted, a lot of people still wanted, you know, alcohol, whether it was hard liquor or beer, but, you know, it was illegal. And they were able to really take advantage of that. And a lot of them grew to be extremely powerful. Around here, we had a guy named Roy Olmsted. He was a former Seattle police lieutenant. Decided that he wanted to get into the bootlegging business. And what he did was he owned... he owned boats, and Canada had prohibition at some point also. The difference was they were still allowed to manufacture their product. They just had to ship it out of the country. So what would happen, whether it was on the East Coast or the West Coast, they'd manufacture, fill up these boats full of alcohol, and ship it off to Bermuda or wherever it might be going. And usually the next day the boat was back and it was empty, and nobody ever questioned why the trip was so quick, but you know, they didn't care because they were still in business. And that's how Roy Olmsted was able to do it. He was bringing it down into the Puget Sound and distributing it throughout the area. Another guy, his name was Pete Marinoff. They called him Legitimate Pete because he felt that you know, the only crime he did was bootlegging, which people wanted it, so it wasn't a bad thing. So they called him Legitimate Peter. He called himself. So what happens is, in the late 20s, early 30s, he decides that something is you know, the winds are starting to change, and people are realizing that maybe Prohibition is going to end. So he ends up buying a couple closed breweries, and he figures, you know, if the time comes, he'll be able to reopen. So 1933, he opens one of his breweries, and prior to Prohibition, the Brewery Workers Union was the main union that worked with most of the breweries, and most of the employees were covered by this union. Well, once Prohibition hit, and you know, hundreds or thousands of employees lost their jobs, the union lost all of that power they had too. So in the interim, the Teamsters had become more powerful. And after Prohibition, the Teamsters decided that they wanted to move in on the breweries. So they were able to convince multiple breweries that they had to be the union for them. Brewery Workers Union were fighting back and forth. Legitimate Pete, though, did not like the Teamsters, didn't like working with them. So at one point, he has delivery trucks going out, and Teamsters that are you know, harassing the drivers, and they would tell restaurants or taverns that if they bought alcohol from them, that you know, they would damage their restaurant, which they would do. Sometimes they'd throw bricks through the windows after they received a delivery. So things like this were taking place. So 1934, he has a contract with the Teamsters. Everything's good. 1935, he can't negotiate with them, so he's sending out armed guards with the drivers. And at one point, there's a skirmish with a Teamster, and a Teamster is murdered. Obviously, the security guard is charged, but Pete Marinoff is also charged, even though he wasn't even in anywhere in the area. But the charge was that he was the one that instituted, you know, it was his fault that this took place. So they charged him. He was actually convicted and sent to jail for 20 years, but they got it overturned pretty quickly. So I don't think he even served 6 months. But the point is that it was back then, especially 1920s, 1930s. You were convicted of a crime. You were tried within a month, and if it was a murder, you were dead within weeks. They didn't drag things out like they do today. But he was able to get out of that. Now, the big one we were talking about earlier, Rainier Beer, was started by it was Seattle Brewing and Malting. And after Prohibition, you know, they were all shut down. San Francisco had been brewing Rainier up till 1920 when the federal Prohibition kicked in. So Emil Sick, originally from Washington, born here, but his family moved into Canada, and his father had started a brewery conglomerate. So he was very well known in Canada and on the West Coast, like in British Columbia and stuff. So what he wanted to do was he wanted to start some breweries in Washington. And he wanted to bring that Rainier brand back because he knew that it had been a popular brand, and it wasn't that he loved the beer or anything, he just saw dollar signs. He knew it would be good because people would remember it and they'd buy it. So what he did was he started a couple breweries, one in Seattle, one in Spokane. He bought other breweries that had been closed, and tried to negotiate with the people that owned the rights, because it was a weird thing. Somehow they had sold the rights to this company in San Francisco. So it was not owned by the people that ran it originally. So he tried to negotiate, and they wouldn't agree to it because there were five different owners. So he made a licensing deal, and he was able to brew the beer and sell it, but he didn't own it. So he worked on that for many years. That was a big thing for him. It took him about 20 years contacting these people, like yearly, every 6 months, saying, "Hey, you guys ready to sell yet?" And finally, in 1953, they agreed, and he purchased the Rainier brand and everything, and it came back to Seattle. So that's where it was. And he became an icon in brewing in the state and in the country. He became well-known. Any smaller breweries in the state, if they weren't doing well, they'd call him up and say, "Hey, you interested in buying us out?" And generally, if it was something that he thought he could use, he would do it. One time, he didn't really want the brewery. He said, "You know, I'm not really in the market, but my daughter wants a typewriter, and I can get a typewriter out of the deal. So, okay, I'll buy it so I can get that." Wow. So, if you've got the money, why not? But he became a big benefactor of Seattle. He helped to found the first blood bank. And he also he owned the Seattle Rainiers baseball team. He built the stadium and everything, and under his ownership, they won several pennants. And they were a big team until Major League Baseball moved to the West Coast, and that league was diminished at that point. So he ended up selling it. And he had been writing his, dictating his biography to his secretary, and he got up to the late 1950s, and he never quite finished it. He died before he got it completed. But it's pretty interesting reading his take on everything. Now, they were not number one in the state, excuse me, always. Olympia was actually, like, in the 1960s, they were like the number one beer in the state. The big brands, the mega beers, they hadn't really pushed up into the Northwest yet. So they were still kind of diminished. It was really more local, but Olympia was the number one beer. So Rainier, what they did in the early 1970s, they hired this small ad agency. There was only a couple people. It was known as Balker Heckler. And they decided that they'd use these guys because they had seen some work they did. And what these guys did was they created a campaign that took Rainier from like top or bottom 10, or, you know, like 9, 10, shot them right up to number one in the state. These commercials, if you haven't seen them, you can go on YouTube. There's like the motorcycle Rainier. There is the Rainier Deer. There are a bunch of commercials. They're just these great, crazy commercials that created a phenomenon in the state and made everybody know who Rainier Beer was. They had the television, they had print, they had radio ads. And when they first started, what they decided was they wanted a name. So they decided that they wanted to get Mickey Rooney. And Mickey Rooney happened to be in Seattle. It was like on a downturn of his career, and he was doing a play. So they were able to get him, and they said, hey, you know, would you do, you know, a series of short commercials for us? We've got a budget of $2,500. And he's like, Mickey Rooney doesn't take $2,500. $3,000. They're like, all right, we'll work it out. $3,000. They do like three or four commercials. Soon as they're done shooting, he's like, can you take me over to this used car lot up on Aurora Avenue? I'm like, okay. Drive him up there. He goes over. He buys a used station wagon for $3,000. He hops in it, and he drives home to California. So obviously, it was not the best time in his career, and he really needed the job. But he liked it. He actually came back and did some more commercials for them because they became so popular, and it kind of got his name out there again, too. So that was a big deal, and Rainier had been doing really well. 1977, out of nowhere, they were sold to Heilman and no longer were a local brand. They had changed their name from Seattle Brewing and Malting after Emil Sick died to it eventually became known as Rainier Brewing or Rainier Beer. But they were just sold. Now, in the 1960s, Olympia, they're number one, and like I said, the mega beer were just slowly starting to put pressure on the other brewers in the state. Olympia knew that they weren't going to be able to last forever at number one, so they figured there was a lot of consolidation, stuff that we've been seeing in the past couple of years, bigger breweries buying smaller breweries. And it was happening at this time, so Olympia ended up going out and buying several breweries over time. 1975, they bought Hams. In 1976, they bought Lone Star. And in 1982, then, out of nowhere, Pabst bought 49% of their stock. And they tried to turn around and buy 49% of Pabst stock, and they were going to fight it out. The Schmidt family realized that they didn't have the resources to do that. And the next year, they sold the rest of it to Pabst. And so in 1983, it became owned by Pabst, which they still, I believe, they're still the owners. There's been a lot of changes between Miller and Pabst and all these different things that have been going on. Originally, their beer was still made in their plant in Tumwater there. But what happened was, at one point, Miller ended up buying that plant, but not the Olympia brand. So Pabst still owned the brand, and Olympia was brewing beer that they were shipping to China out of that plant. But Pabst needed a place to brew the beer too, so they worked out a deal with Miller to brew Olympia in their old plant that's owned by Miller, and it was kind of a sad mess thing, but it's just all subcontracting stuff. But so this is 1980s, all the iconic brands from Washington had pretty much disappeared. 1982, a guy of Scottish descent opened the first brew pub in the United States since Prohibition. Anybody know what that is? That's right, Bert Grant. In Yakima, it was the first brew pub since Prohibition. He kind of took a stab at it. Nobody else had done it. And the craft beer industry kind of started. There were some other in California and some other places, there were some things going on, but this was kind of the start of it here in Washington. It became a pretty popular place. Now Gordon Bowker, the guy from that ad agency that made those great Rainier ads, eventually left that ad agency. He did some other things. He helped to co-found several businesses, including Starbucks, and another one. The place that started in a transmission shop in Seattle, and that was Red Hook. And it was his idea. They brought in a brewer, and pretty much just created this beer out of nowhere and created this great great business that, it's still around today. It is now owned by multiple entities. But again, several of these businesses are still around. That so Washington, like the original breweries, were able to survive to like the late 70s, early 80s, and then these craft breweries started to slowly open up. 1984, a councilman, an electrician over in Colville opened a business. He decided he wanted to become a brewer. He went over to Europe. He learned how to brew. And his name is Mike Hale. And he opened a brewery there. Colville, small town that would drink, you know, mega beer. It was kind of hard for him to get people to understand the beer that he was brewing. So he ended up shipping a lot of it to Spokane, where he would sell it. Eventually, he opened a plant there and opened another plant. Kirkland, maybe. And was it Kirkland? And yep. And then moved over to Seattle, where the final current plant is. And again, since 1984, they've been around. Mike Hale is one of these great pioneers. I interviewed him a little over a year ago. And he is really about one of these. You go to your closest brewery to get your beer. If it's homebrew, then that's obviously the closest one. But if you're going to go to the closest brewery, because that's going to be the freshest, best beer. And he's really a proponent of that. 1984, another brewery opened up and started as Heart Brewing. And their first beer was known as Pyramid Pale Ale. So they grew over time until they finally, they moved up to Seattle too, renamed their brewery Pyramid. And again, slowly a lot of these were starting to form. 1985, Will and Mari Kemper were partners in another brewery known as Thomas Kemper. And that brewery would later merge with Pyramid and become part of that. But Will Kemper decided I don't think he was even there when it merged with Pyramid. He had left already. And he went on to be a consultant. He traveled around the world helping breweries open up. He opened breweries, I think one in Philadelphia, in Turkey, in Mexico. And then they came back home and they're up in Bellingham now. They own Chuckanut Brewery. So if you like beer that is right to style, you like a Pilsner or a Vienna or whatever, they do great beer that is just whatever it's supposed to be. And he's really, they just opened a new production facility because they could not produce enough. They didn't even have a salesperson until last year because they could not produce enough because they were landlocked where they were. So they just opened their production facility in Skagit County. And now they're going to be able to try and get beer all over. But another big brewery that a lot of people think is just a tourist attraction is one that Roseanne and Charles Finkel started. They were originally wine importers, but like Charlie Finkel says, there's nothing that says that it's not like being a Democrat or Republican. You can like beer and you can like wine. So he said they liked beer also, but they liked really good beer and they liked European beer, so they started a beer importing business. And they started that in 1978. They went through a lot of iterations of it, and then finally in 1989 they opened Pike Brewing in the Pike Place Market. And he's a great, again, another big proponent, both of them are, of Washington beer and really pushing, you know, local beer and stuff. Now, there were a lot of breweries that also opened during this initial phase. Some of them are other ones that are still around, Big Time, Roslyn, Maritime Pacific, Leavenworth, but there were a bunch that didn't make it, and that's something that that we're seeing today. Even as of tomorrow, Big Al Brewing is closing just because of increased competition. There's been more open in the past couple months. Several other breweries have opened. There's more that are expanding, but I think part of it is maybe location, maybe the beer. You know, if you're a small brewery, you've got to have people coming in. Or you've got to be able to do distribution to, you know, to restaurants and other places. But it's still a great thing. You know, the late 90s, there was a fallout. That's when a bunch of them had closed. But the new wave really kept things going. And, you know, there's over 4,000 some breweries in the country now. So it's really changed a lot. But does anybody have any questions about brewing, about Washington beer? Well, none of the. There's other of you that probably know more about brewing than I do, but yes.
So my question is this. So a lot of those companies that you talked about were brewing and malting, right? And like malt has other uses besides beer. So, but you never hear, I never heard about them like staying in business by just focusing on the malting.
Yeah.
Like, is that something that happened? I mean, were they still malting?
The early brewers, a lot of them also did their own malting too. A lot of them had like Seattle Brewing and Malting. You know, a lot of them did that. Sometimes they did it just, they added the name. Like maybe they'd malt one time so they could add that name to it. But malt, as far as I know, there weren't many. You know, there were other uses. And during Prohibition, there was there were some companies that would provide a kit. You could buy a kit that would include like yeast and a malt. But they weren't together. They were two separate things. And if you took them home and somehow they mixed together with water and became an alcoholic product, you know, that could happen. But they were not sold as that. You know, so there were some companies that sold malt like that, but it wasn't a big thing. In any of the research I've done, I don't recall any. Some of the malt companies were able to stay in business themselves, but the breweries usually not.
And then, if I can follow up one more thing, was like you talked about Henry Weinhart, right? And Henry Weinhart's also famous for their like non-alcoholic drinks now, right? Which my understanding was they got into that also because of Prohibition. Is that true?
That could be. I mean, they were on in Eastern Washington, and his nephew ended up opening a brewery out there. He moved to Portland. He went back and forth between Portland and Vancouver, and eventually settled in Portland. But yeah, it could be like the Thomas Kemper Company. They started a line of sodas, so it's entirely possible that was the reason that that line of drinks came about.
Awesome, thank you.
If there's anything else, or not anything else, then thanks very much for coming in, listening.